The Economic Community of West African States, ECOWAS, is making significant strides towards the launch of the single currency initiative known as the ECO. This initiative, endorsed by Nigeria, is expected to drive economic growth and development across the region. The ECO is set to be integrated into the 3-in-1 identity cards planned for rollout by NIMC. Joining me for more on this, I have with me Dr. Josh Bamfo, partner and head, Transfer Pricing and Economic Advisory Services, Andersen Nigeria. Thank you for joining me today.
Thanks for having me.
Well, the implementation of this single currency is due to come into effect in 2027. Well, it appears to have been relaunched. We know there was this lull in 2023, but now it appears to be, you know, relaunched. Now, talk to us about the importance of this project to the region's economy and development.
Yeah, so clearly this initiative has been in the pipeline for a while. I mean, prior to COVID-19 in 2019, we thought that by 2020, they would have launched it. But that wasn't the case. And we've had COVID and we deal with post-COVID and challenges and all that. So it's exciting for us to recognize that it's back on the table. They've set a very clear timeline for its launch in 2027. And the hope is that if it's properly implemented, then clearly having a common or single currency within the community, which is the ECOWAS community, would actually boost trade amongst the community and member countries. And by boosting trade, that could lead to increase in production of goods and services, lead to high economic growth, create jobs and opportunities for the youth of these nations, and therefore lead to economic development of the member countries. So that is the vision in terms of how it's supposed to achieve economic growth and development. Through that same process, when you have a single currency and it's boosting trade, then it becomes a region for foreign direct investment destination. You know, so hopefully it attracts more foreign direct investments to the sub-region and then create more job opportunities. Hopefully it can also lead to some stability of some macroeconomic variables such as, you know, inflation, exchange rate volatility, and all that. So by and large, the expectation is that it's supposed to be beneficial to the member countries if it's implemented, you know, effectively and successfully.
All right. Are you concerned about the transition plan for existing national currencies? How will that play out?
So clearly, there are going to be two things. You know, there's first and foremost the criteria that needs to be met for the transition to occur, and then how you transition away from existing national currencies to a single currency within the sub-region. Clearly, there may be concerns. In fact, in 2021, there were conversations about whether to look at an alternative as opposed to going with a single currency. Why shouldn't they consider a common currency and the various member countries keep their national currencies as it is? But it looks like they've settled for a single currency, which means that the national currencies have to be phased out, you know, and the single currency used on a going forward basis. My expectation would be that that transition will be in phases, wouldn't be abrupt. For those in Nigeria, we do recall under the previous CBN governor, when there was there was a need for them to actually replace the old currencies with a new one, and that process wasn't implemented effectively, the kind of problems it created in terms of its adverse impact on economic activities, shortage of those new currencies in circulation and all that. So my expectation would be a phased approach, you know, in terms of phasing out old currencies to the newer currency, which will be ECO. But even before that, there are a number of macroeconomic criteria that needs to be met. And that is even more important in terms of whether member countries will be able to achieve, you know, those targets.
All right, let's get right into that. I mean, talking about the criteria for this currency, there is the budget deficit of less than 3% of GDP. There is also inflation being limited to 10% and a, you know, debt of less than 70% of GDP. Not only that, each country must actually adhere to this criteria for 3 years before the ECO can be launched. First, how many of these 12 countries? I'm saying 12 countries because we know of three that have sort of pulled out. So how many of these 12 countries meet this criteria, and for how long have they met it?
So clearly, before I even talk about whether any of the member countries have met this criteria or not, is to even look at the fact that, you know, it's extremely important that these ambitious targets are set. As to whether they are going to be achieved or not is the next question, right? It just shows the intent being right. Because without the macroeconomic fundamentals of those member countries, those 12 member countries being strong, there's no way having a single currency is going to be successfully implemented. Currently, as we speak, if you look at the very large economies, all right, within the 12 member countries that you talked about, take Nigeria, Ghana, Cote d'Ivoire, and Senegal. In fact, across board, no country has so far adhered to all three, you know, as of today, right? But let's focus on the four. Take Nigeria, for example. Debt to GDP ratio, yes, we've achieved that. It's around 44.1%. That is clearly below 70%, which is good news. If you look at the budget deficit to GDP ratio of less than 3%, Nigeria hasn't met that. It's around 5.6, depending on which data you are looking at. When you look at inflation, we know that inflation is the biggest challenge that Nigeria is facing today when you look at macroeconomic instability. As of May 2024, we are around 33.95, way significantly higher than the 10% target. So Nigeria being the largest economy, which is supposed to be a major driver of the success of this single currency policy, significantly fails two out of the three major criteria. You go to Ghana, the next largest economy, you know, in West Africa. When you look at debt to GDP ratio, they are way above the 70% threshold because of the currency crisis that they went through recently. Look, depending on the data you're looking at, as of 2023, debt to GDP ratio was hovering around 85%. Inflation has been a big challenge for Anglo-African countries that are not part of the safer post-COVID. At some point, Ghana's inflation rate was way above 30%. Today, it's around 23.1%. Significantly above the 10% threshold. Budget deficit to GDP ratio, depending on the data you're looking at, 2023, it was around 7.5%, significantly above the 3%. So you look at these two major Anglophone countries within the economic ECOWAS community, they've not met, you know, most of these criteria. Now let's even go to the Francophone countries, because they are already experiencing a form of single currency, which is the CFA, which is tied to a very strong, you know, currency like the euro, you know, because of the relationship they have with their colonial masters, France. All right. Good news. You look at it in terms of inflation. They have one of the some of the lowest inflation rates across board. In the case of Cote d'Ivoire, it was around 4.7%. In the case of Senegal, it's around 3% or lesser. Right. So inflation is not a problem for them. You know. However, when you go to debt to GDP ratio, because they have more control over fiscal policy, right? If they have any macroeconomic challenges, they have to rely on the budget to actually resolve that. In the case of Senegal, depending on the data you're looking at, some project around 75% for 2023 and 2024 when you look at debt to GDP ratio, which will be higher than the threshold that we are talking about, right? But they are, you know, they have to then look at the budget deficit to GDP ratio. So no country within the ECOWAS community has met all three criteria yet. Now we have up to 2027, which can argue to be 4 years. They need to meet all three, and to have been able to meet it for three years before it gets launched in 2027. So will we be able to launch in 2027 based on this particular requirement? I think it's a stretch. But the good news is they need to set ambitious targets, which if they have the political will and are able to even achieve most of them, for me, that would be a win for the ECOWAS community. The question is, will they have the political will to actually try to achieve those targets?
Let's look at Nigeria. I mean, how long will it take Nigeria to get to that, you know, inflation band, looking at where we are today?
It's going to be a challenge. A couple of things that are going to help. We've seen some of the policy prescriptions that are coming from the presidency and the Ministry of Finance, where you see fiscal policy being used as a very important tool to help curb inflation. For the most part, it's been monetary policy. It's been the CBN increasing monetary policy rate significantly in order to curb inflation. What we know is that major sources of the inflation are not on the demand side. It's more on the supply side. It's just production of agriculture products facing problems in terms of insecurities, you know, transportation costs going up because of the removal of fuel subsidy, which is a fiscal policy challenge. The liberalization of foreign exchange market leading to significant depreciation of the Nigerian currency against hard currencies. It's a monetary policy side issue, and I think the Central Bank of Nigeria has to pay more attention to that, because without that, you know, inflation is not going to come down, because you're going to have imported inflation adding to some of the domestic sources of inflation. So the good news is that there seems to be renewed, you know, commitment to bringing inflation down, both from the fiscal policy side and what we've seen consistently on the monetary policy side. As to when they're going to be able to get closer to the 10% target, that is yet to be determined. Come next year, there's going to be a base effect. If average prices are already higher the previous year, then without actually bringing the future prices down, the base effect will bring that inflation rate down anyways. So my belief is that come next year, inflation rate will be more reasonable. As to when we'll be getting closer to the 10%, that is yet to be determined. First and foremost, the first thing we need to see is, when does it taper off? Let's look at the June numbers. Are we going to, for the first time, be able to observe inflation rate actually declining? Are we going to get something lower than 33.95%? That will give the Central Bank of Nigeria some confidence that their policies are working. Because if they continue to increase monetary policy rates, and interest rates continue to rise, and cost of borrowing continue to rise, it's continuously hurting the investment community in terms of businesses and the ability to expand their businesses. So the earlier we get inflation coming and trend, the better for the rest of the economy, and the better for our chances of really launching ECO in the 2027 target timeline.
Right, just before I let you go, do you see other challenges or risks, you know, when we look at this particular single currency goal?
Clearly, there are going to be challenges. I mean, in 2020, the challenge was Nigeria going to be on board? You know, they have the incentive to be part of it. The good news is, with our President Tinubu being the chairman of ECOWAS and giving his commitment, at least that challenge is no longer there. There seems to be a renewed commitment by the largest economy within the ECOWAS community. So at least that challenge is no longer there. The second challenge, the political challenge, is how do we deal with those three other countries, the Sahel countries, whether we're going to carve them out and focus on the 3 and 12 remaining member countries, or at some point, are we going to incorporate them, and how are we going to deal with that? The other challenge is, are all these countries committed to giving up, you know, control over monetary policy to a central a central bank that will serve the whole community, and so therefore you are only limited to fiscal policy. For now, it looks like they are all committed to doing that. Let's see whether that commitment doesn't waver. The final bit, you know, for me, is going to be the political world. It's so easy to come up with targets. It's so easy to say you are committed. Whether you are willing to make the tough decisions to achieve these conversion criteria targets is going to be the biggest challenge. If by next year we are not seeing inflation numbers trending significantly downwards for the large economies such as Nigeria and Ghana, you know, if you are not seeing debt to GDP ratio coming down for a country like Ghana and Senegal, you know, those are going to be big challenges, because these are the bigger economies with the US community. So a lot will be dependent on the success of these four large economies that are going to be the major drivers. And for me, that will pose a big challenge if we don't see significant gains in terms of their macroeconomic stabilities going forward.
Dr. Josh Bamfo, partner and head, Transfer Pricing and Economic Advisory Services, Andersen Nigeria, thank you for your time and your thoughts on Business Edge today.
Thank you for having me.